Hello everyone. Today we are going to discuss inflammation. In that we were discussing, in previous video we had a discussion on those chemical mediators. Here in the cases of chemical mediators, it can be released from cell or the plasma. Today we will discuss those plasma derived mediators and myself Dinesh Dangar. This point comes under Gujarat Technological University, Semester 3, Pathophysiology, UG Pharmacy. Here, in cases of plasma-derived mediators, or they are plasma protein-derived mediators, or the plasma proteases. This includes the various products that is derived from the activation and the interaction of those four interlinked systems. See, there are four interlinked system that is already working within the body. That is kinin system, clotting system, fibrinolytic and the complement. Out of these four, during second semester, we have already studied the clotting mechanism or the clotting system. That is blood clotting. Now, in this case, Heisman factor of the clotting system plays a central role in interaction of these four systems. Here, in case of Heisman, right, while considering the Heisman, that is the activation of factor 12 in vivo, while considering in vivo, that is inside the body, by contact with the basement membrane and the bacterial endotoxins. That these are these two, that is basement membrane and the bacterial endotoxin, that acts as a stimulus for the inflammation. And while considering in vitro, that is outside the body, glass or kaolin, that it can act as a activation of the factor 12. In cases of inflammation, activation of factor 12 is generally brought out or be carried out by the contact of the factor that is leaking through the endothelial gaps. Here, the end products of the activated clotting, fibrinolytic and the kinin system activates the complement system, and this complement system further generates the permeability factors. This permeability factors in turn further activates the clotting mechanism. First, here we will go through each system, starting with the kinin system. Here, the system on activation by factor 12A that generates bradykinin. Here, we have already discussed during the bradykinin during cell derived mediators, that is bradykinin, right? That is from platelets. Here, it is why it is named bradykinin, because of its slow contraction of the smooth muscles. It produces the slow contraction of smooth muscle leading to bradykinin, or that's why it is called as a bradykinin. How bradykinin is formed? That in that case, first kallikrein is formed. How kallikrein is formed? That kallikrein is formed from the plasma prekallikrein by the actions of the prekallikrein activator, which is the fragment of factor 12A. So here we need to understand the kinin system. In that we need to have the basics, that is what factor 12. Factor 12 activates those prekallikrein activator. Right, that prekallikrein activator activates those prekallikrein molecules. Further, that prekallikrein will get converted into the kallikrein, and now that kallikrein acts on those higher molecular weight, that is kininogen, to form bradykinin. Understand? Factor 12A, next is prekallikrein activator, next is prekallikrein, next is kallikrein, and now this release kallikrein acts on those high molecular weight kininogen to form bradykinin. Now, this bradykinin acts in the early stage of inflammation, and its effects includes the contraction of smooth muscle. It may produce vasodilation, and it can lead to have a increased vascular permeability leading to pain. So here what it will do, it produces smooth muscle contraction, vasodilatation, increased vascular permeability and causes pain. That is about the kinin system. Remember factor 12A, next is precranicalin activator, next is preclaricrine, next is calicrine. Calicrine acts on the kininogen to form bradykinin, and that bradykinin forms, or the bradykinin acts on the inflammation, or it may have a role in inflammation. Next system, that is the clotting mechanism or the clotting system. We have already detailed study during first semester and the second semester, human anatomy and physiology. Here, as we know that factor 12, that has been, that factor 12A initiates the cascade of the clotting system, that is the events, right, that is cascade. So here, factor 12A initiates the cascade of the clotting system, resulting into the formation of fibrinogen. Here, while considering that fibrinogen acts on the thrombin to form a fibrin. In starting cases, that fibrin will have a soluble in nature. Right? After that, it may form a insoluble fibrin layer, as well as it forms fibrinopeptides. So here in clotting system, it is activated by the factor 12A, and it acts on the forms fibrinogen, right, from fibrin. Next is further, it acts on the thrombin to form fibrin. Now, that the actions, while considering the clotting mechanism or the fibrins, the actions of those fibrinopeptides in inflammations are like increased vascular permeability. Next is chemotaxis, or it acts as a chemoattractant agent for the leukocytes. So that further, at the site of injury, there will be accumulation of leukocytes, or the sudden flow of blood can lead to have an increased number of the leukocytes, and it may produces anticoagulant activity. Okay, so that is about the clotting system. Next is the fibrinolytic system. That is the third system. That is the fibrinolytic system. It is activated by the plasminogen activator. Here, the fibrinolytics, you would try to understand those words, fibrinolytics. So, these are the agents which lyses the fibrin. Okay. So, here it activated by plasminogen activators. These plasminogen activators acts on the plasminogen that is present in or is component of the plasma protein to form plasmin. So, it is that plasminogen actor will be present inside the cell. Where? In plasma. Okay. So here, those the plasminogen presently have their effects on the or as a plasmin. The action of plasmin in inflammations are like first, that is activation of factor 12, that is to form precalicrine activator that stimulates the kinin system to generate bradykinin. So here, that actually precalicrine will get activated by the fibrinolytic. So ultimately we can say that fibrinolytic activates the kinin system. That as I have stated earlier, these four systems are interconnected. Right? These four, that is the kinin system, the clotting system, fibrinolytic and the complement system. They all are interrelated. Here, so further, first there was a activation of factor 12. Next, effects of the plasmin. It splits off the complement C3 to form C3A, which is again a permeability factor, which could enhances the permeability, that is vascular permeability. And due to that vascular permeability, during inflammation, the components of the cell, components of the blood plasma or blood itself or those blood cells may leave the circulation and it may reach toward the site of the injury. Here, plasmin degenerates fibrin to form fibrin split. This is the main action. That's why it is called as a fibrino lytic agent that may lead to have a lysis of fibrin, right? Here it degenerates the fibrin to form fibrin split. Products which increases the vascular permeability and are chemotactic to leukocytes. Due to that degenerated fibrin, it causes the increased vascular permeability, or it increases vascular permeability. And again, it acts as a, that plasmid itself acts as a chemotactic, or the chemoattractant molecules, and that those chemoattractant molecules will be released at the site of injury, so that it can gather, or you know, it can directly stimulate those cells which may have a direct role in inflammatory conditions. So that is about the fibrinolytic system. Next system, the complement system. This is the fourth and the last system that comes under plasma protein derived mediators, or it acts as a plasma proteases. Here the activation of complement system can occur either classic through the classic pathway or the alternate pathway. While considering the classic pathway, right? While considering the classic pathway, it may involve the antigen antibody mechanism, or the antigen antibody complexes, or through the alternate pathways like non-immunologic agents such as bacterial toxins. Next is the cobra, or the cobra venom and the immunoglobulin E. Here complement components, it is numbered as a C1 to C9, and they are present in plasma, and it is itself, it will be in inactive form. Here the complement system on activation further leads to anaphylotoxins like C3A, C4A and C5A. While considering that C3A, as we have discussed it during the fibrinolytics, because it splits off the complements, that is C3 to form C3A, right, which can enhances the permeability, or it acts as a permeability factor. So here there will be a formation of C3A, C4A and C5A, as well as there will be a formation of membrane activation, or sorry, membrane attack complex, right? It further, its activation of complement system leads to have a formation of membrane attack complex, that is MAC. While considering the effects of the anaphylotoxins during the inflammation are, it releases the release of histamine, that is from the mast cells and the basophils. There will be a increased vascular permeability that may causes edema in tissues, right? As we know that while considering any injury, surrounding tissues or the cell membrane are damaged, or cell may undergo damage. So even it can lead to have a gathering of the fluid, and that gathering of fluid may involve the dead cells, dead red blood cells, as well as WBC cells, certain components of the skin or the layers of the skin can lead to have a edematous fluid gathering. Here, under the influences of anaphylotoxins, C3A augments the phagocytosis, right? That is the whole process, as we have already discussed during the last lecture, that is phagocytosis. And C5A is a chemotactic factor for the leukocytes. Here it acts as a chemotactic factor. And at last, the outcomes of the acute inflammation. See, while considering the inflammation, as we have divided it to two, that is the acute inflammation and the chronic inflammation. Here in cases of acute inflammation, there will be a complete resolution. What is that complete resolution? That, as we have discussed early during the pathogenesis of cell injury, any type of cell injury, if it follows reversible, that means the damage is up to one extent, and further the normal what we can say, that normal nomenclature, or the their normal appearance can be reverted back, or the normal structure can be reverted back, then it can be called as a reversible cell injury. In most cases of reversible cell injury, it follows acute inflammation, or it can be termed, or it can be termed as a acute inflammation. So at the end of the event, that is what, starting from the injury, next is whole pathogenesis and the wound healing, right? Next class we will have a discussion on wound healing too, right? So here just understand, try to understand that that is what, that complete resolution, that is from day 1 to day 14, suppose day 1 to day 14, right? So at the end of the inflammation, the skin may have a normal appearance. That is what, the complete resolution of the injury or the inflammation. Here the healing will be done by the connective tissue replacement. What it means? It follows the fibrosis or the formation of scar, right? That is what is at the end product of the clotting mechanism, right? That we have already discussed in cases of clotting mechanism or the clotting system, where exactly, under the influences of factor 12, it activates factor 12A. Next is it initiate the clotting mechanism, where exactly the fibrin will be produced, and that fibrin further undergo the fibrin split, or the fibrin may produce certain products, and that may be directly correlated with the complement system. So here the healing, right, the specific damage or the surrounding tissues, it will be replaced. In cases, the replacement will be done by the connective tissue, that is surrounding tissues, right? Next is, in cases of progression, while considering the progress of acute inflammation, if we are not treating this, if we are not treating acute inflammation, then it may progress towards the chronic inflammation, right? So here the ultimate goal of the acute inflammation will be to retard it to progress up to the chronic inflammation, or up to that time only it can be termed as acute inflammation. If we are not treating it, we are, you know, not about the, you know, the mechanism behind it, or the, we won't treat it, that means it follows chronic inflammation. So what we have discussed today, that is during this lecture we had a discussion on the plasma proteases or the plasma protein derived mediators. In that, Heisman factor, that acts as a initiator, and we had a discussion on these four, that is the kinin system, next is the clotting system, next is fibrinolytic system, and the complement system. In cases of kinin, what we have, that is kallikrein or the bradykinin. In cases of clotting system, that is there will be a formation of fibrin, and in cases of fibrinolytic system, there will be a role of plasmin, which directly lead to have a anticoagulant actions or anticoagulant property. And at last, the complement system, that is from C1 to C9. So that is all about the today's class. Thank you very much.